Hi, this is Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at InterArbor Solutions, and you're listening to Briefings Direct. The path to cloud computing adoption appears complex and risky to both government and enterprise IT leaders, recent surveys show. This next Briefings Direct Managed Cloud Methodologies discussion explores how tackling complexity and security requirements upfront helps ease adoption of cloud architectures. By combining managed services, security solutions, and hybrid cloud standardization, both public and private sector organizations are now making the cloud journey a rapid stepping stone to larger business transformation success. Stay with us now as we discover how cloud-native apps and services modernization benefits from pre-built solutions with embedded best practices and automation. To learn more, please join me now in welcoming our guests. We're here with Raj Raman, Cloud Chief Technology Officer at Unisys. Welcome, Raj.
Thank you very much, Dana.
We're also here with Jerry Rhodes, Cloud Solutions Architect at Microsoft. Welcome, Jerry.
Thank you, Dana. My pleasure to be here.
We're glad to have you. Raj, let's start with you. Why are we still managing cloud adoption expectations around complexity and security? You know, why has it taken so long to make the path to cloud more smooth and even routine?
Well, Dana, that's a great question. Some specific thoughts, especially given that I do spend quite a bit of time with some of our customers. So a common theme that we are seeing, be it a government agency, a federal agency, a public sector, or a commercial customer, many of them are actually driven by organizational mandates. And sometimes getting those organizational mandates in place often proves challenging, more so than what one thinks. Then the other part is that while AWS or even Azure may be very easy to get onto, the question then becomes is how do they scale this up in terms of complexity? Because then that means that they have to either figure out how do they develop in-house capabilities, or they come looking to a partner like Unisys to help them out. And last but not least, a very clear mandate such as digital transformation or a specific initiative where there is a core sponsor around it, oftentimes it does ease the whole focus on some of these. So these are some of the reasons that we see why actually cloud complexity and as well as app transformation can be quite arduous for many of the clients.
Jerry, what are you seeing from your perspective on getting organizations, in a sense, cloud ready before they get into being cloud consuming? What sort of best practices jump out at you in order to make this a smoother on-ramp?
Some of the better practices that I see beforehand is what is your end game going to look like? What is your overall cloud strategy going to look like? So instead of just lifting and shifting in a workload, what is that life cycle of that workload going to look at? So really a lot of in-depth planning with either whether it's a government agency or private enterprises, they all really have a lot of, after we get the mandates out of the way, it's really, okay, I need this application that's running in my on-premises data center. I need to run it in the cloud. How do I make it happen? Do I lift it and shift it, or do I re-architect it? And if so, how do I re-architect for cloud? And that's really one of the big common themes that I'm seeing is how do I re-architect my application to take advantage or better advantage of the cloud?
You know, one of the things I've seen is a lot of organizations do well with their proof of concepts, and they might even have multiple proof of concepts in different parts of the organization, but then getting to that standardized, comprehensive cloud adoption is a different beast. Raj, how do you make that leap from spotty cloud adoption, if you will, to more holistic?
That's a very relevant observation, Dana. Some of the things that we have seen, and this is what we help customers and we advise customers, is rather than try and take it all or do it as a one-size-fits-all, for example, we have one particular client that comes to my mind who were trying to at once try and shift thousands of applications. Now, they did follow through in terms of doing a very detailed POC, and they got the yield from the POC. But when it came to actually then going about doing the actual migration and the transformation, they decided to feel that, okay, that they were convinced and they felt confident that they could take on and try and do en masse thousands of applications. The thing is that in trying to do that, not all applications are one size. So one needs to go about figuring out how do you have a phased approach to it towards doing an application discovery, an application assessment, and then based on that, you can then determine which applications, quote unquote, are well worth the effort. So what we recommend to customers is that think of migration as a fairly phased approach. Be very clear in terms of what you want to achieve. Start small, gain the confidence, then have a milestone-based approach of going and accomplishing it. So that's what we, and especially in some of my conversations, I actually go out of my way to go and recommend that.
Now, we're also seeing sort of mandates come down from above. Maybe in the federal U.S. government, for example, cloud is becoming increasingly important. We're expecting somewhere in the vicinity of $3.3 billion to be spent for federal cloud in 2021, and upwards of 60% of federal IT executives looking to modernization efforts to increase their challenges for security. They've got both the cloud and security issues to face. Private sector companies are also seeing these mandates of cloud native and cloud first thinking come down. So, Jerry, when you've got that pressure as an IT organization, but you've also got the complexity that we've discussed and apps that are across the board on all kinds of different platforms, you know, what are you looking to from Unisys as an alliance partner to help make those mandates come to fruition?
Very, very, very good question. Working with partners such as Unisys. Those partners know the customer. They're down on the ground with the customer. They know the applications. They know the customers. They understand the mandates. We understand the mandates. We have the technology within Azure. Unisys, however, understands how to take our technology and integrate it in with their end customer's mission.
And security is not something you bolt on or think of after the fact. So, Raj, we're seeing organizations trying to tackle cloud native and improve their security. How is Unisys and Microsoft coming together to help them, in a sense, accomplish those as a tag team rather than a sequence or even worse, a failure?
Dana, we recently conducted a survey of some of our stakeholders, including some of our customers too. And no surprise, security, be it as part of the migrations or in scaling up already the existing workloads or the current initiatives on the cloud, by far security was one of the top three areas of focus as well as concern. So some specific areas that we are already partnering with, in this case with Microsoft, we have our flagship security offering, which is Stealth. This is one of the industry-leading products. So actually a good example of where we are not just in collaboration, but call it as actually a leapfrogging innovation, where the Azure team has actually released a very specific API to make products like Stealth work. And this now gives customers more choice, and it allows Unisys to help meet customers in terms of where they are, right? So that's one very specific example. The other one is in the first half of the year, we actually worked very closely with the Microsoft team to release our Cloud Fortifor Azure. This is the foundational elements to help both government as well as commercial customers leverage Azure as a platform for doing their digital transformation. So those are two very specific examples. And then Microsoft team has also stepped up and working very closely with the Unisys team to help not only the Unisys, both in terms of our developers and architects, get native in terms of all things on Azure, but also help customers understand how best to go and consume Azure. So those are very specific examples in which we see the collaboration with Microsoft really, really scaling really well.
Jerry, of course, there's more than just technology here. These are business services. So whether a public or private organization, making that change to more of an operations model, paying as you consume, and even developing budgeting and the different financial instruments you need to measure and manage cloud services could be a big leap. How is that working out? And why is this a team sport when it comes to not just adopting cloud services, but changing the culture of the business services that constitute cloud native adoption?
Yes, one of the biggest challenges that I hear from a lot of our customers are going from a CapEx model to an OpEx model. So they don't really understand how it works. And the other thing too is with a pay-as-you-go type model versus CapEx, where it's standard, you know, it's a standard, here's the price and here's how long it's good for until I have to then re-up, you know, buy a new piece of hardware or re-up the license or whatnot. Using cloud, it's pay-as-you-go. So if I launch 400 servers for an hour, I'm paying for 400 virtual machines running for 1 hour. So if we don't have a governance strategy in place to stop something like that, we could then wind up going through 1 year's worth of budget and do that in 30 days easily if it's not governed, if it's not watched. And that's why, for instance, working with Unisys, with CloudForte, there are built-in controls to where you can actually go through and ping the Azure backend, such as our Cost Explorer or our CloudDen product, where you can go through and see how much your current charges are, as well as forecast what those charges are going to look like and get ahead of the eight ball, if you will, to make sure that you're actually burning through your budget correctly versus getting a surprise at the end of the month.
Yeah, Raj, same question. How do you help organizations manage that cultural shift in sort of the business consumption around cloud?
Yeah, Dana, I think adding to Jerry's point, right, we see three dimensions over here to help customers. One is what Unisys calls that basically setting up their very clear cloud architecture and the whole foundations. We actually have an offering geared around this. And again, good example, maybe collaborating with partnering with Microsoft. It is, think of it as how do you codify best practices? Because on the cloud, we see five pillars that customers have to contend with. Not one pillar, five pillars. There's cost, there's security, there's performance, there's availability. And then there's operations. And each of these can be quite complex and very deep. So rather than customers having to figure these out themselves, what we have done is we have gone ahead and using a combination of a product and a framework, we have codified, saying that here are the top 10 best practices you may need to be aware of in terms of security, cost, vice versa. What this does is it makes it very easy now, both for the Unisys consultants and for the architects, as well as for the customers to understand at any given point, be it a pre-migration, post-migration, saying that they have a very clear visibility in terms of how they stand against their review and posture on the cloud. The second bit of it is that thinking about security and compliance upfront, not as an afterthought. Because oftentimes what happens is customers go quite deep into the journey and then they realize that they may not have the controls and the postures in places. And next thing you know, it's a totally different exercise. And then they start to lose confidence. So rather than wait for that, the thinking is that how can we arm them, think about giving them the governance and the policies on all things security and compliance. And Azure has got very good capabilities towards this. The third bit, and Jerry touched upon this, is financial governance. The ability to think about not just cost as a matter of spinning up a few Azure resources up and down, but think about it in a holistic way in a governance model where you can break it up in terms of underutilized to utilize resources, the ability to go to do chargebacks and governance, the ability to go and optimize the cost on an ongoing basis. So these are very distinctive foundational elements that we're starting to arm customers with, Dana, as a way to then make them a lot more comfortable and gain the trust as well as a part of the process.
You know, Jerry, the good news about cloud offerings like Azure and hybrid cloud offerings like Azure Stack is you've got more of a standardized approach, not necessarily one size fits all, but an important methodological consistency and technology consistency. But organizations are often, of course, coming from their own unique legacy, years and years of everything from mainframes to N-tier architectures and applications that come and go. How do we look to the Unisys and Microsoft Alliance to make the best of standardization for cloud, but also recognize that there are specific needs to organizations that need to be dealt with?
We do have Azure Stack for an on-premise Azure deployment. We also have Azure Commercial Cloud, as well as Azure for Government, or our Government Cloud, as well, and DoD Clouds. The good news is that they're all the same portal, same APIs, same tooling, same products and services as you would find them across all three clouds. Now, as services roll out, they'll roll out in our commercial cloud first, and then we'll roll them out into government as well as into Stack. But the good news is those products are available. We don't have to do any special type of configuration or anything in the back end to make it work. It's the same experience regardless of which product the customer wants to use. With CloudForte, for instance, CloudForte can work with Stack. It can also work with commercial and Azure for Government. And for the end customer, it's the same cloud services that they expect to use. The difference really is just where those cloud services live, whether it's on-premises or with Azure Stack on-premises on a cruise ship or in a mine, or if you're going with Azure Commercial Cloud, or if you need a regulated workload, such as a FedRAMP High workload or an IC4, IC5 workload, then you would go into Azure Government. But the difference is there's no different skills that are required to use any of these clouds. Same skill set, so you don't have to do any up training. same products and services. And if the products and services aren't in that region that you're using, by all means, you would work with Unisys or myself to engage the product teams to put those products in those in Azure Stack or in Azure for Government.
And Jerry, how does the Unisys Cloud Forte managed services offering complement these multiple Azure cloud environments and deployment models and still take into account the fact that each enterprise that's moving to the cloud has its own unique footprint, if you will, or history?
With Cloud Forte, it really standardizes it. So there's different levels of Cloud Forte, for instance, and the underlying cloud really doesn't matter. It's going to be the same experience to roll that out. But more importantly, what it does is I look at Cloud Forte really as kind of an on-ramp. A lot of times I'm working with customers and they're like, well, gee, how do I get started? So whether it's setting up that subscription and tenant, getting them on board with that, as well as how to roll out that proof of concept. How do they do that? And that's where we would leverage Unisys and Cloud Forte, is they're the on-ramp to roll out that first POC, and whether that POC is bare bones Azure virtual network, or if they're looking to roll out a complete soup to nuts application with application services wrapped around it, Cloud Forte and Unisys can provide that functionality.
I would like to add to the point that Jerry is making, right? The way Cloud Forte has been designed as an offering, as a bolt-on, especially on top of Azure, is there are two key themes that actually drive the whole offer itself. One, meet customers where they are. It's not about what Unisys is trying to do or Azure is trying to do. It's about, first and foremost, we are obviously customer obsessed, but we want to help customers do things on their terms and obviously do it the right way. So Cloud Forte has been designed to go and accomplish and meet those twin objectives. And the way we go about doing it is that if you imagine, if I can give you a visualization of, imagine a flywheel, and then the flywheel has got four parts to it. One, the whole consume part of it, which is the ability to consume Azure workloads at any given point. Next is the ability to run command or the whole operations piece of it. Then you follow that up with the ability to go and accelerate transformations, be it a migration or app modernization. Last but not the least, to go and transform the business itself, be it on a new technology, AI, machine learning, blockchain, anything that can be run on top of Azure. The beauty of the model is a customer does not have to buy all of these en masse. They could be well fitting into any of this quadrant, right? Like some customers come and say, hey, we just want to consume the cloud workloads. We really don't want to do the whole transform piece of it. Or some customers say that thank you very much. We already have the basic consumption model outlined, but can you help us accelerate and transform? So the ability to provide flexibility on top of Azure to help customers meet where they are, right, is that's the way Cloud Forte has been envisioned, and a key part of why we are so passionate and bullish in working with Microsoft to help meet customers their goals.
Great, thank you. Now, we've talked about technology, we've talked about process, but of course, people and human capital and resources of talent and skills are super important as well. So, Raj, what does the alliance between Unisys and Microsoft do to help usher people from being traditional IT to being more cloud-native practitioners? What are we doing about the people element here?
Again, a very important question, Dana. In order to be successful, one of the big focus areas with Unisys is to arm and equip our own people, be it at a consulting level, at a sales-facing level, be there doing cloud architectures or even doing cloud delivery. Across the Stripe rank and file, there's an absolute mandate to increase the number of certifications, especially the Azure certifications. In fact, I can also share that Unisys, as we speak, right, every month we have a doubling of people who are across the rank of Azure 300 and the 900. These are the two popular certifications, the whole Azure stack of it. We have now north of 300 plus trained people, and maybe my number is at the lower end. It's maybe much, much higher than that. A rank file, and we expect the number to be doubling, right? So we have absolute commitment, because customers do look for us to not only come in and solve the problems, but to do it with the level of expertise that we claim to do, right? So that's why our commitment to getting our people are trained and certified on Azure is a very important piece of it. And then Microsoft Teams, too, have stepped up by making not only access to their documentation, but also making their personnel available, if need be, to help Unisys get scaled up in terms of the needed certs and the whole expertise on all things Azure?
All right. One of the things I love to do is to not just tell, but to show. Do we have some examples of where the Unisys and Microsoft Alliance and your approach and methodologies to cloud adoption, tackling the complexity, addressing the security, looking at both the unique aspect of each enterprise and their skills, their people issues, all that coming together. Do we have some examples?
We have quite a few of our federal agencies who are actually quite reluctant for them to be in the spotlight. That said, what I can do, share is I can give representative examples that we have some very large defense establishments that are working with us. We have some very specific state agencies who are close to the DC area, but these are the agencies that are responsible for the rollout of cloud consumption across the statewide mandate. So as a part of that, we are well on our way in not only working with the Azure teams, but also with the state agencies, because each of the agencies then has got citywide, region-wide, and within that, they have a health agency or there's an agency focused in terms of education, social services. So it can be, so in some of our experiences, we're seeing that there is an absolute interest in terms of adopting the public clouds for them to achieve their citizens' mandates. So those are some very specific examples that I can quote. And vice versa, I would also say, I would also extend my own examples of that, Dana, to say that, again, on the whole enterprise side of it, we actually have a California State University that's been a long-standing customer of ours. A good example where they have transformed their own university infrastructure using Cloud Forte with a specific focus on all things hybrid cloud. And we're pleased to see that not only the customer is happy, but they're quite eager to keep partnering with us in terms of making sure that their mandates are met on a constant basis.
And Jerry, when we look to these both public and private sector organizations, how do you know when you're doing cloud adoption right? Are there certain things you should look to that you should measure? You know, obviously you'd want to see that your budgets are moving from traditional IT spending to cloud consumption, but what are other metrics that you should look to say, hey, you know, we're actually getting this right?
Actually, one of the metrics that I look at is cost, because usually when you get in, you do a lift and shift, or maybe you're a little bullish when you start building out your environments. When you are doing cloud adoption right, you should see your costs start to go down. So your consumption will go up, but your costs will go down. And that's because you're taking advantage of either PaaS in the cloud, being able to auto scale out, looking to move to, say, Kubernetes and start using things like Docker containers and shutting down those big VMs and going with clusters of VMs and then running your Kubernetes services on top of them. So usually when you start to see those costs go down and your services going up, that's usually a good indicator that you're doing it right.
And just as a quick aside, Jerry, we've also seen that Microsoft and Azure are becoming very container and Kubernetes oriented. Is that true?
Yes, it is. We actually have Brandon Burns, as a matter of fact, who was one of the co-founders or co-creators of Kubernetes during his time at Google.
All right. Same question, Raj. How do you know when you're getting this right? What do you look to as sort of the chief metrics from Unisys' perspective when somebody's gone beyond proof of concept and they're really into a maturity model around cloud adoption?
To my earlier point, one of the things that we take very seriously is our mandate to customers saying that we want to do cloud on your terms and do it right. And what we mean by that is something very specific. So I'll break it into two quadrants there, Dana. One is from a customer-led metric perspective. We actually rank ourselves very seriously on terms of Net Promoter Score. We have one of the highest in the industry relative to the rest of our some of our competitions as well. And that's something that's hard-earned, but we keep striving to raise the bar on terms of how our customers talk to each other and they feel about us. Then the other part of that is the ability to retain the customers, so retention. So those are two very specific customer-focused benchmarks. Now, building upon some of the examples that Jerry was talking about, from a cloud metric perspective, besides cost and besides cost optimization, we also look at some very specific metrics, such as how many net workloads are there under management. What are some of the net new services that have been launched? We especially are quite curious to see there is a focus on terms of Kubernetes or AI and machine learning adoption. Are there any trends towards that? One of the very interesting ones that I'll share, Dana, is that some of our customers are starting to come and ask us, like, that can you help set up an Azure cloud center of excellence within an organization. So that oftentimes is a good indicator that the customer is looking to transform the business beyond the initial workload movement. And last but not the least is training, right? An absolute commitment to getting their own organization becoming more cloud native. So those are some very specific things, examples that I'll throw up, look to go and track.
I'll toss another one in, and I know it's hard to get organizations to talk about it, but you know, fewer security breaches, fewer days or instances of downtime because of a ransomware attack.
That's right.
It's hard to get people to talk about it. You can't always prove when you don't get attacked, but certainly a better security posture as compared to 2 years, 3 years ago would be a high indicator on my map as to whether cloud is being successful for you. All right, we're almost out of time, but let's look to the future. What comes next when we get to a maturity model, when organizations are comprehensive, standardized around cloud, they've got skills and culture oriented to the cloud, regardless of their past history? We're also, of course, seeing more use of the data behind the cloud in operations and using machine learning and artificial intelligence to gain AOps or AI ops rather, benefit. So let's look to the future. Where can we look to even larger improvements when we start to employ and use all that data that's now being generated within those cloud services?
So Dana, one of the things that's very evident to us is as customers start to cut over and use the cloud at significant scale, it is very hard for them. For the matter, it's very hard for any one organization. Even for Unisys, we see this, which is how do you get scaled up and keep up with the rate of change that that the cloud platform vendors such as Azure are bringing to the table. All good innovations, how do you keep on top of that? So that's where a focus on what we're calling as AI-led operations is starting to become very important for us, which is the ability to go and look at the operational data and help these customers go from a reactive, from a hindsight-led model to a more proactive and a foresight-led model, which can then guide not only their cloud operations, but also help them think about where they can now leverage this data and use the Azure infrastructure to then launch more, you know, innovation or new business mandates. That's where the AI ops piece of it, or the AI-led operations piece of it kicks in. Then the second piece of it is that what we're seeing is that although many customers start to feel quite comfortable that they have started to understand, but on an ongoing basis, we keep telling them that there's a reason why cloud is called as a continuous, right? So ability to have continuous visibility, be it compliance or security, the ability to have constant optimization, both in terms of best practices, reviewing the cloud workloads on a constant basis and make sure that their architectures are being assessed for the right way of doing Azure best practices, right? So these are, and then last but not the least, one other trend I'll surface up, Dana, as a part of this, which is we're seeing starting to see an increase in the level of conversational bots. Again, because many customers that at least that we talk to are interested in getting to a self-service mode. So that's where we see, at least we starting to form an opinion that conversational bots built on, say, on Azure or Cortana will become even more mainstream.
Jerry, last word to you. How do organizations recognize that the more cloud adoption they have, the more standardization, the more benefits they'll get in terms of AI ops and others? What is the future as a sort of a virtuous adoption pattern kicks in?
Yes, actually, to expand on what Raj was talking about with AI ops, we actually have built in a lot of AI and ML into our products and services. One of them is such as with advanced threat protection, ATP on Azure. Another one is with anti-AI phishing mechanisms that are deployed in Office 365. So as more and more folks are moving into the cloud, we are seeing a lot of adoption around these products and services, as well as we're also able to bring in a lot of feedback and do a lot of learning off of some of the behaviors that we're seeing to make the products even better. So one of the things that I, in working with my customers, is DevOps. How do we employ DevOps in the cloud? So a lot of folks are doing DevOps on premises, and they're doing it from an application point of view. I'm rolling out my application on infrastructure that is either virtualized or physical sitting in my data center. How do I do that in the cloud? Why do I do that in the cloud? Well, in the cloud, everything is software, including infrastructure. So it's software. Yes, it sits on a server at the end of the day. However, it is software defined. Being that it's software defined, it has an API, I can write code. So therefore, if I want to blow out or roll out a suite of virtual machines, or I want to roll out Kubernetes clusters and put my application on top of it, I can create definable, repeatable code, if you will, that I can check into a repository someplace, press the button and roll out that infrastructure and put my application on top of it. So now deploying applications, especially with DevOps in the cloud, it's not about I have an operations team and then I have my DevOps team that rolls out the application on top of existing infrastructure. Instead, I actually bundle it all together. I have tighter integration, which means I now have repeatable deployments. And I can do my deployments instead of doing them every quarter or annually. I can do deployments. I can do 20, 30, 1,000 a day if I do it right.
Well, terrific. I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. You've been listening to a sponsored Briefings Direct discussion on improving the path to rapid and even routine cloud computing adoption. And we've learned how an alliance between Unisys and Microsoft combines managed services, security solutions, and hybrid cloud standardization to usher both public and private sector organizations to larger business transformation goals. So please join me in thanking our guests. We've been here with Raj Raman, Cloud Chief Technology Officer at Unisys. Thank you, Raj.
Thank you, Dana.
We've also been here with Jerry Rhodes, Cloud Solutions Architect at Microsoft. Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you, Dana.
And a big thank you as well to our audience for joining this Briefings Direct Cloud Computing Adoption Methodologies discussion. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at Intra Arbor Solutions, your host throughout this series of Unisys and Microsoft-sponsored Briefings Direct discussions. Thanks again for listening. Please pass this along to your community and do come back next time.